Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our webinar this afternoon, College Admission Scams, Mitigate Your Risks of Being the Next Headline. My name is Tom Barnard. I'm going to be moderating a group of speakers today, all from Baker Donelson and Charles River Associates. And we thank you for coming out to listen to our webinar. A couple of housekeeping notes I'm going to go over. There is a Q&A box on your screen. You can submit your questions. We're going to try to look at those when there's a little bit of time at the end to make sure we get through all the substance. We appreciate your feedback, so please take time to complete the survey, and we really like to hear how we can make this more helpful in the future. A PDF of our presentation will be available in the resource list, and feel free to connect with us over Twitter at the bottom of your screen. Here's today's agenda. We're going to walk through a number of topic areas that will be very helpful in analyzing these problems and kind of coming up with plans on how to deal with them and give you some very practical approaches. Your presenters today are a number of highly qualified individuals, including from our labor and employment group at Baker Donelson, Angie Davis and Jennifer Curry, and Larry Laurenzi from our government investigations practice. Peter Resnick is joining us from the Charles River & Associates forensic services team, who's going to be offering some valuable insights in his specialty. We're here, obviously, because of what's been all over the news. The scandals and the recent updates has really inspired us to say, you know, we should be reaching out and offering some services in this area. And where I'd like to begin with is some opening remarks by Linda Klein, who's a past president of the American Bar Association, is a senior managing shareholder at Baker Donelson. Linda, thank you for taking the time to join us.
Oh, thank you, Tom. And reflecting on all of this, at a time when everything about colleges and universities is measured and judged by outsiders who are journalists or politicians or otherwise not education professionals, the recent news makes our lives as lawyers who advise schools much more difficult. The public is growing ever more cynical, and the admission scandal feeds this feeling. As a child, I said the Pledge of Allegiance every morning in grammar school, with liberty and justice for all. So as Americans, we're raised to believe that hard work in primary school will lead to opportunities in higher education. We then face the reality that higher education is not free, and many work harder to earn scholarships. And without scholarships, we take on debt. Regardless, we have a right to believe that the published admission rules of our college will be followed. Now it's our job as lawyers to shine a light on what's wrong, fix it, and restore public trust and confidence in the system. Whenever society cannot fix a problem, it falls on lawyers to remedy it. Lawyers help level the playing field to assure that women and people of color would have access to quality education. So it's our turn to step up again. And this distinguished panel has so much to offer, and I'm looking forward to learning from them. So I thank you, and over to Larry.
Thank you, Linda. I was with the Department of Justice for right under 36 years, and during that time, I got to prosecute a number of cases. And as I look at this indictment, I think it is significant. It is not significant because it involves movie stars or chief executives. I think that it is significant in its breadth and in its scope, and that it addresses the affairs of what's going on in our colleges and universities. On May the 12th, which was just a few weeks ago, more than 50 people were charged in the U.S. Attorney's Office in Boston. 12 people were indicted. They were indicted under the theory of racketeering, which is an extremely serious charge. Of those people, you had 6 college coaches. You had 1 tennis pro. You had 1 administrator for a school out in California. and they were all charged with a conspiracy to commit RICO. At the same time that those people had been indicted, there were 33 complaints that were filed by the office in Boston, and many of those complaints were against people who had paid money to Rick Singer in an effort to get their kids admitted into various schools. On that particular day, in a courtroom not far from where the grand jury returned their indictment, Rick Singer entered a guilty plea. And he entered a guilty plea to four counts. One was obstruction of justice. Another was forfeiture. But the big charge that he pled guilty to was racketeering, which, again, is an extremely serious charge, which carries a significant period of jail time. Also, at the time that the information on Mr. Singer was unsealed, there were three other informations filed. Two of those were against college coaches, one at Stanford and a second one at Yale, as well as a test taker down in Florida. When I said that this is a significant case, it is significant because the department chose to use one of its most potent weapons, which is the RICO statute, to hold the people accountable for these offenses. And let me talk for a second about Rick Singer. Mr. Singer, as alleged in the indictment as well as the complaints that were filed, is focused on committing frauds in two areas. One, as it relates to people who were taking tests, and that is really not that unusual. There have been similar cases, but maybe not to the breadth that we had in this case where so many schools were involved. But there was also the charge of bribery, which involved multiple schools, not only in the Massachusetts area, but from across the country. Mr. Singer got involved a number of people in various colleges at a level that has never been done before, and that he was able to use these people to gain admission for people who may not have otherwise been admitted. One of the issues in this case is who's the victim. Many of the colleges have already come out and want to declare themselves as victims, but I think a number of people are also seeing that the victims in this case are the people who apply to the various schools. As this has been elevated, it is my opinion that the Department of Justice will continue to focus its efforts on what goes on in colleges and universities. In addition to the fact that criminal charges have been filed, there are also other things that are happening. After the indictment was filed, it would come as no surprise that civil suits, class action suits, have already been filed in San Francisco. Both of them named the schools specifically, and these are issues that will now have to be dealt with by the schools. And in these particular class action lawsuits, the allegations are going to focus on whether or not the schools were negligent in allowing this type of conduct to happen. In addition to the civil suits that have been filed and the fact that criminal investigations are continuing, you now have the Department of Education, who has now entered and they are conducting their own investigation. The fact that a criminal case and has occurred and that indictments have been handed down does not stop the regulatory agency from conducting its own internal investigation. In this case, the majority of the schools have already received letters notifying them that the Department of Education is conducting an investigation and it is going to focus on their admissions and has already requested 10 years of records from each of the schools. So I think everyone can see that this case is having a very profound effect, not only on the colleges that have been involved in the fraud, but it's going to have a profound impact on colleges and universities across the country. Jennifer?
So we're looking at where does that leave you in your institution. Believe it or not, you have all of the data and information now currently in your possession to assess whether you have any vulnerabilities in the admissions and recruiting process. You just need to essentially determine how to mine and analyze that data information, which is really what this presentation is going to get into now, about how you, using the information already in your possession, is going to be used to best protect your institution. The scandal is really a wake-up call to practice some good hygiene in the admissions and recruiting space. And you should do this before you're facing a government investigation or a lawsuit. So what should you be doing? Your first step is to really be conducting an internal audit. And in doing that, you need to build your team. And that team should be well-versed in both compliance and legal concepts and should have a good understanding of your current policies that are in place. My main warning to you on this piece is that your team should not include anyone who is going to be connected to either admissions or recruiting in any way or have any relationship that would cross a certain line with any individual who's part of recruiting or admissions. The last thing you want to do is to conduct an audit only to find that it was somehow tainted by an auditor or an investigator involved in the admissions or recruiting process. So that means you need to vet your team very thoroughly before selecting who is going to be on that team. Second, you should be considering engaging counsel to lead or at least participate in the audit. And this is going to be particularly important where your institution may be facing criminal culpability, allegations maybe that are raised or evidence is uncovered suggesting that senior management or even members of your board are involved in some way. Legal counsel is also going to be important where the financial risks are particularly high or where litigation is likely to ensue. And when I say legal counsel, I don't mean your in-house counsel. The use of outside counsel is preferred and is going to be helpful to ensure attorney-client privilege is maintained during the course of your audit or your internal investigation. Most case law out there indicates that investigations or audits conducted by in-house counsel are routine and done pursuant to their business function, which would include compliance and would not necessarily be privileged. So you also don't want to get into the position of relying on your in-house counsel as being the individual involved in the audit who would then produce or create privilege that would prevent you from having to produce information or findings related to the audit that you conduct. So that is why outside counsel is particularly helpful. And even if you don't want to necessarily use outside counsel from the start, another good point to remember is that you can always pivot and identify outside counsel to get involved. It's never going to be too late, particularly when you start finding information that creates additional liability.
Great. This is Peter Resnick. So just following up on what Jennifer was talking about, you know, look, any review in this situation is going to have a number of goals to it. You know, number one is obviously identify any existing issues and problems. You know, two is going to be to help make the organization better, improve controls, make everyone more aware. And then third is, you know, to demonstrate that as an organization you are compliant, you know, you do the right things when issues do come up, and especially if later on there are regulators, you know, asking, you can demonstrate, you know, what you did and how you did it. Now, the beginning of any review is going to start with risk identification. And, you know, identifying those risks will help you build out the scope of an investigation plan. Obviously, in this particular situation, we have a roadmap from what the indictment and the news is reporting. And so, you know, that clearly is going to be a starting point, but it doesn't necessarily end there. You know, what else do you know? What else should you know? And what else can you know? And, you know, when you're performing a risk assessment, I think it's important to look through past areas of concerns through a new lens. Obviously, here we do have a particular fact pattern. There may be things that have come up, whether it be in your hotline activity, in findings from internal auditors, or maybe management letters from your outside auditors, where at the time felt, you know, somewhat innocuous or maybe not as significant, but now with the bright lights of what's going on in the news today, it may feel a lot more significant. And, you know, and obviously there, you're always going to be looking for what we call in the forensic world red flags and other areas where you're going to want to, you know, look further. And I think every organization, those are going to be different. You know, schools with, you know, more high-profile athletics may have different red flags than schools where they're, for example, getting lots of, you know, grants or things of that nature. So it's going to vary, but definitely, you know, identifying those risks out of the gate is what is really key. So, so you know, the other piece that's really helpful in, yeah, you can go. That's, you know, in assessing those red flags is, you know, talking to people. I wouldn't say in doing, you know, formal interviews, and we'll talk a little bit about more formal interviews in a moment, but, you know, doing some high-level inquiries. People, you know, anytime things like news today, you'd like to think that you, you know, you have an environment where people are stepping forward and raising issues, but sometimes they need a little bit of prodding and asking people what those, you know, what that roadmap may look like to some other things that are raising concerns. So whether it's talking to people in admissions or, you know, athletic recruiting or, you know, in other, you know, core areas of your organization, you know, having some of those discussions will be helpful in your identification of these red flags. And then, you know, without sounding self-serving, performing a real risk-based forensic audit procedure, you know, procedures to see whether these risks are in fact problems, or maybe you'll hopefully find out that you have a great compliance environment and they're not actually problems. So, you know, what are some of the key steps in a forensic audit? I think the first thing I may do is for a moment is just, some people like to ask what is a forensic audit versus just a regular audit. You know, your audit done by your outside independent accounting firm is to assess whether your financial statements are materially accurate. A forensic audit is, number one, usually done by specialists who focus on fraud and conducting investigations. Two, it's usually done, not always, but usually done under privilege at the direction of counsel. And, you know, your outside auditors cannot do that and maintain independence for the financial statement audit piece of it. So it's bringing together a specialized team that will then allow you to to do this work in underprivileged, as I said. So, you know, some of the steps are going to be interviewing key employees, and obviously interviews tend to be very useful part of any investigation necessary. And I think there becomes a, you know, important thought process as to when to do it and what information you gather beforehand. There's going to be the data gathering. Jennifer talked about the fact that you have a lot of data, and you're going to have the admissions data, you're going to have recruitment data, and it's going to be the analytics and the, you know, looking to see where there are correlations that may help you further vet out where whether there are in fact issues. Talking about looking at donations, I've found in other investigations, money coming in, or whether it's revenue or donations, people are happy about it, as opposed to sometimes looking at it and saying why or how and what, why is this new source of donation coming in, and at least looking at it through a different lens than what you might given what's out there. You know, I'd say there is really no one-size-fits-all approach for every school. It is going to be different, and that's why sort of having specialists at your side is particularly helpful. And then, you know, I think I've touched on a lot of these, but, you know, for somebody who's in this role, you know, the job of a forensic investigator is to identify information so that triers of fact and decision makers and the lawyers can determine what those mean in the context of the laws. And, you know, our role is the same whether we find something or don't find something. So we bring objectivity and independence to the process, when, especially if the government is there later down the road. Sometimes some environments are very political and asking the hard questions difficult, and we can do that in maybe a slightly less confrontational way. And again, I think at the very end, we're able to kind of put a bow on it so that it does come through as a very independent, thoughtful investigation, and its findings can be relied upon.
All right. Thank you, Peter. So, you know, once you have identified what kind of audit you need to conduct and who your auditor is going to be, you need to start getting ready for the audit itself. And your first step is to identify every department and every individual who you must engage in the audit. In this case, it's going to be every department and individual who participates in your admissions and recruiting process. You should be over-inclusive here. So don't just focus on the traditional departments, but expand your scope to departments that include athletics, grants, scholarships, et cetera. In order to keep focus, we recommend that you even create an organizational chart to be clear on where the connections lie between these departments and individuals. Next, you're going to create an audit plan. You know the players, now you need to determine what you need from those players. And at a minimum, your plan should identify each of the current applicable policies in place and set time for review of those policies so you can best understand the rules that your people are expected to follow internally. Your audit plan should also identify each set of documents and data that you're going to need to gather, and then each witness you expect to interview. I do want to leave you with one note for creating your audit plan. So while this plan is going to be a necessary step before you get started, you need to keep in mind that any investigation or audit is going to need to be fluid and flexible. So as you gather and review your policies and documents and data, or as you interview witnesses, you may discover information that requires you to adjust your plan, perhaps add on witnesses, add additional documents or data that you need to collect. You should never be beholden to the plan you create at the start, and you should always be prepared to revise and retool your plan in order to go in the direction that the facts are going to be taking you. Then, after you have your plan set, you need to actually gather your information. You should keep and preserve every document and record gathered and reviewed as part of the investigation. That's going to include your internal policies, the admission standards, application and testing records, any admission records, and recruiting records. Don't just assume that those records are going to be available to you in perhaps a year after the investigation or audit is complete, when that audit might be tested. You might go back and find that those documents aren't there anymore, or the policy might have changed. So it's important for you to preserve the records or the documents that you gather at the time of conducting your audit. It's also important, this step, is in case you have to actually, you have a situation where you discover that information has been tampered with. For example, Peter has a really great example of a story about SAT and ACT scores, if you want to chime in for a minute, Peter.
Yeah, I was. I've done a number of investigations into misreporting of financial data for the purpose of schools trying to alter their ranking data, and you know, I've seen cases where students get admitted, and then once they are in, then people are changing the records. So somebody who came in with a 1100 SAT, 6 months later, the system is showing them as having a 1350. Not only is it impacting the ranking data, it's actually impacting the student into what type of classes they're being placed into and other factors. So, I hope
right.
that
so
helps.
That's why it's really important for you to collect and hold on to or preserve the documents that you gather or the data that you gather during the course of your investigation while you're conducting the investigation or the audit. Because, again, you cannot assume that that information or data is going to stay the same or is going to be available to you down the line when you might have to defend your audit or if the audit needs to be examined later on by perhaps the Department of Justice or during the course of litigation. So this step is really important as an initial step regarding the documents and information. We also recommend that in addition to simply gathering the documents and information, you actually create an inventory of every piece of information that you deemed to be essential to your investigation. That should include not only the documents and data you gather, but also the witnesses you interviewed and the key information that they provided during the course of their interviews. Again, just like documents or data, you can't always assume that the witnesses that you interview are going to be available to you later on down the road if your audit gets challenged or comes under scrutiny. So you want to keep any information that you collect from your witnesses, which would include any notes that you might have, and any reports that you might create as a result of a witness interview. So whether you're in an audit or defending yourself in a lawsuit, you know, a failure to preserve and record the information collected and reviewed is likely to create an inference that the record or information either said something different than what you are indicating it says, or that it perhaps never existed. The most extreme examples of this come during the course of litigation, where case law across every jurisdiction in this country has made very clear that a failure to preserve records when potentially facing litigation requires the court to infer that those records either never existed or included facts that were adverse to your case. So you need to think a few steps ahead beyond just this audit for internal purposes, but how this might impact litigation down the road if you are ever facing litigation or perhaps a Department of Justice investigation. And finally, you may come across issues that make preservation and inventory of that information impossible. So as you are considering your preservation efforts, you should keep in mind that individuals involved in recruiting and admissions may be using forms of communication that cannot be preserved. And the ones that come to mind are either Snapchat or WhatsApp, which is encrypted. Your institution right now should have a policy against the use of those kinds of communication, particularly where your institution either issues the electronic device or pays for the use of the device. And it should have a prohibition against individuals involved in the admissions or recruiting process from using those apps. That's because you want to make sure that the communications that they are engaging in, at least in the written form, are preservable and they are collectible. And if your institution doesn't have such a policy, it should be put in place as quickly as possible. You, as an employer, have the right to dictate to your employees how they are using the devices that you are either issuing or supplying. In this case, we're largely talking about cell phones and tablets. And you can restrict the use of that equipment in ways that are to your benefit or are going to be helpful to your institution down the road. So if you have that kind of policy, it's important to then know who has violated that policy, what kind of communications they may have engaged in, and potentially preserving any documents or communications that can be preserved during the course of your investigation.
Hey, Jennifer, it's Tom. Just as a side note on that, there's also, if you work with your IT folks, you can make settings for, let's say you have the issued phones and things, where all texts from a company-issued phone are backed up to the cloud. You know, you can that's available for most of the phone services and the IT services. So that's something to explore that you as a, you know, you can have those settings in place. A lot of people don't even activate that option.
That's an excellent point, Tom, and it should be put in place if possible. Next, we're going to move on to training your stakeholders. So as you move through your audit, you should be identifying the stakeholders in each department or division of your institution that are going to be held accountable for any misconduct regarding any admissions or recruiting. So those individuals are not only going to be responsible for their own conduct, but they're also going to be responsible for making sure that the individuals and the process that they oversee comply with the internal policies at your universities or institutions. And once you've identified those stakeholders, you're going to potentially ask them to participate in the audit. And if you do, it's imperative that you advise them of their confidentiality obligations. It is the case, you know, in the case where they assist you in uncovering fraud or any type of improper conduct during the course of an audit, as a stakeholder, they need to understand that their confidentiality obligations to your institution are going to be absolute. And finally, as far as those stakeholders go, they must not only be required to assist in your audit and informed of their confidentiality obligations, but they also are going to need to be trained in fraud itself. You cannot assume that any of these individuals just intuitively know what is right or wrong or what could bring liability to your institution, because it's not always necessarily intuitive. They need to be trained in what is considered misconduct in the admissions and recruiting world, how to properly identify it, how to avoid it, and what steps they should be taking once they believe misconduct has actually occurred. These stakeholders have to understand that they will own this responsibility, and their failure to police their own departments or divisions and their supervisees ultimately is going to fall on their shoulders.
Great. Okay, so this is Angie Davis. I'm the Vice Chair of the Labor and Employment Group here at Baker Donelson. And what we're going to talk about next is, what do you do after you've determined your outliers? And in the labor and employment context, we've done a lot of these audits along the lines of either Department of Labor and Fair Labor Standards Act audits, when you're doing a self-audit to determine whether people are working off the clock, whether overtime is being paid accurately, whether your employees are classified correctly. And under the pay equity context, you do the data gathering like Peter discussed here. We work closely with a forensic auditor to gather all of the data. and then to create a list of outliers. Who doesn't fit the norm? So in the pay equity context, what we do is gather, okay, how long have these employees been working for us? What is their education level? What is their experience level? And what is their expected pay? And you have a range of expected pay. And then if the person is not within that range, they're considered an outlier. They're either being paid more or they're being paid less. In the context of the college admissions and recruiting type of an audit, you gather data such as SAT scores, grade point averages, recruiting information. Where did they play in high school? What were their college records? What are the records of their efforts in an athletic program at a college or a university? You know, part of the issues that we've seen in these scandals is that kids are being admitted into these colleges and universities as players of a certain team, and then they don't really play on the team. So what is the record evidence? What are the statistics that that child had for playing on the team? Are they showing up at practice? So you gather all of this data together, and then you look at your outliers. Okay, well, what are there students that we have who've been admitted who are way below the ACT or SAT requirements, or that their grade point average is low? You cross-reference that with donations from parents or nonprofit organizations that could be associated with that child or that student, and then you look at your outliers and you figure out, okay, who do we need to ask more questions about? And then you start your independent interview process. And you can do this either through an attorney, through human resources, through some of your high-level executives at a college or university. But the people that you are going to need to interview are the faculty, the coaches, the admission staff. You know, why is it that this person was admitted to this university when they don't meet our average on grade point average and SAT or ACT scores? I mean, are they a star athlete? Okay, that might be a reason why they're an outlier, and we let them slide in under these other scores because of their athletic ability. So then go interview the coaches. Make sure that person is playing on the team. Figure out if there is a legitimate reason for that person to have been admitted to the school, and then determine if there's not a legitimate reason. And in the pay equity context, when you do this sort of analysis and you get through the interview process, you go and determine if there are legitimate reasons and if there are not legitimate reasons. And then you have to figure out, if there are not legitimate reasons, what are you going to do to correct that? In the college admissions scandal type of audit, if you find that there is not a legitimate reason, we would propose that you reach out to someone who is a government investigations type of an attorney to get some very specific advice of what do you do if you find a problem. So what are the must-dos if you find a problem? Do you have any reporting obligations? We've seen that the Department of Labor has come out with a program called PAID. For those of you who have done self-audits on the FLSA and wage and hour issues, this is a new program that's been created by the Department of Labor, and it's called Payroll Audit Independent Determination, the PAID program. And what the Department of Labor did is they set up this program that encourages people to do their own self-audits, and if you find that there are violations, to report those violations to the Department of Labor, and then you get some kind of a discount. So, for example, under the FLSA context, if you do a self-report, you're only looking at 2 years times two for liquidated damages, and they don't seek the third year for willful and intentional as an exchange for you coming forward with that self-audit. We haven't seen those kind of programs come forward yet in this type of context, but you need to ask someone who has some criminal expertise, is there a reporting obligation, and what do I need to do to report? The second thing is you need to stop the problem. And you'll see when we talk about some examples in the recruiting scandals later on, when you stop the problem, a lot of times that means you terminate an employee. You terminate that athletic director. You terminate that coach. What are the other corrective actions that need to be taken? If you have employees who commit misconduct, obviously there's a wide range of what actions you can take depending on how severe their involvement was. Of course, the key is going to be with regard to your employees, What did they know and when did they know it? What has their participation been? Have they been involved? Were they aware of any bribes that were going on or any illicit activities, or were they kind of on the sideline and didn't have any knowledge of that? And so that's a question that you're going to have to answer. If you find that they did have knowledge of it and they did participate in it, and when we talk a little bit about the Adidas scandal in a few minutes, we'll talk about the fact that they wiretapped phones of these individuals who were talking about cash payments over time, and I will pay your child, I'll pay this parent if their child will sign with this particular school. If you have tape recordings like that of someone who is an employee at your college or university, obviously you're probably going to want to terminate them for that. If it is a less clear picture, you may decide to take a lesser action that would be remedial in nature. You may suspend them for a semester without pay. You may do a write-up in their file or those sorts of things. That's with regard to employees who you find participated in or had knowledge of that misconduct. The next question is students. What do you do with students? And so when you see some of the news media that's been focused so much on these issues, I see a distinction. In some of the cases, the students were absolutely aware that their parents were making these payments and bribes and were a part of it. But in about 50% of the cases, there was a concerted effort for the coach and or the parent to hide the information from the student. So it's going to be really important to figure out, do we have any evidence that the student was aware of this? Because they may be innocent. Maybe mom and dad did it behind their back and they didn't realize they were supposed to be part of the water polo team. If the student was involved and if the student did, for example, take pictures of them participating or of someone else participating in the water polo sport, and they Photoshop their face on that person and turn those into a coach, okay, then they probably did have knowledge and they did participate in it. So would that, under your policies and procedures, call for expulsion? Again, the key is, what was their involvement? What kind of evidence and proof do we have of that? And then under this corrective action, what do you do about the money? So if you do find that there has been some illicit payment or some kind of a donation that is in support or in exchange for getting the child admitted to a college or university, do you require repayment of the money? How do you handle the money situation? And again, we suggest that you call our government investigations experts on that particular matter to figure out what you need to do to follow the money trail. With regard to documentation, I know Jennifer Curry talked a little bit about the importance of this, as did Peter. I mean, clearly you need to document your investigation, but on this aspect of it, you need to also document whatever your remedial action was. So come to a conclusion. At some point, you may have to judge the credibility of the witnesses. You may have to look at the documentary evidence, determine which witnesses you believe, whether you do have a legitimate reason for the outlier. If you don't have a legitimate reason for the outlier, did you take remedial action? Did you suspend somebody without pay? Did you terminate them? What actions and what steps did you take as an employer to end that inappropriate behavior? Because that's going to be important that you've documented those actions that you've taken, so that if the government does come knocking to investigate, you can say, we did our internal investigation, we found that there were some issues, and here are the actions that we took to stop that problem. That shows a good faith effort on the part of the college or university to eradicate the problem, as opposed to the alternative, which is sweeping it under the rug, turning a blind eye, and not dealing with the situation. I would be remiss if I didn't point out how important it is to consult with counsel. I have seen this in my 20 years of practice a lot on the OFCCP and wage and hour audit issues, where companies really try to do the right thing, and they do an internal audit, and they do an analysis of their entire workforce, and they try to come up with the, you know, people who are the outliers, and they come up for the explanations for that, and they don't involve outside counsel, and some of them don't even have an in-house counsel. And so what happens when the Department of Labor comes to do an audit, they do a records request, and they say, turn over any and all records related to any internal audits that you've done. So if you have not included counsel and it is not protected by the attorney-client privilege, in that situation, as well as in this type of an audit that we're talking about today, you would be required to turn over all of your investigation notes to the government willfully. You have to, because it's not protected by an attorney-client privilege, absent consultation with a lawyer and some directive from lawyers about next steps and those sorts of things. So I'm going to turn it over now to Larry for a minute to talk about why due diligence is important. What do we care from the government's perspective, Larry?
And I'm going to follow up on what Angie was talking about. What do you do? Do you do nothing, or do you notify the proper agency of the issue? In 2015, then Deputy Attorney General Sally Yates issued a memo, and in that memo she addressed whether or not an organization itself should be charged. In trying to decide whether an organization needs to be charged, Yates directed that all of the U.S. Attorney's offices and all of the Department of Justice employees are to ask this question. And that is, did the organization cooperate? And by cooperate, it means, did the organization willingly turn over all of its records? Did they turn over all of the interviews? And if, in fact, that type of action is taken, then the organization itself gets to potentially sidestep any criminal liability as well as extensive civil liability. But the question is, what should we do? Why are we doing this? Why do we have this due diligence, and why is it important? I talked to you for a second about the Yates memo, which focused on the fact that it was going to be individual culpability. But in 1999, Eric Holder, who was then Deputy Attorney General, issued another memo. And in this memo, it addressed those factors that all prosecutors and all assistant U.S. attorneys who handle civil cases are to take into account in deciding who to charge, and specifically whether an organization should be charged. Eric Holder listed eight factors, but I'll touch on two. One, he told the assistant U.S. attorneys to ask themselves, did the organization have a compliance program and was it effective? If it was an effective compliance program, then that would militate that, in fact, no action should be taken against the organization, but instead should focus on the individuals. A second question that Holder directed that people within the Department of Justice is to consider is, what and how did senior management operate the organization? Were they reckless? Did they ignore facts that were obvious? Were they intentional? In those organizations that acted recklessly, whether it's a business corporation that is dealing in money management, whether it's a bank or whether it's a college, if the people in charge were watching what was going on and paying attention and doing good work, conducting the audits as they should, then the direction coming down from the department is that that organization, regardless of what it is, should not be pursued either criminally or civilly. However, if that group was reckless, ignored facts which they should have known, then they should be considered both for civil action as well as possible criminal action. One last fact that the Holder memo did touch on was it did ask for the impact on any shareholders or stakeholders. And I think that that goes to the benefit of all colleges and universities and really somewhat removes the organization from being considered itself as a potential criminal target. But at the same time, I think that people within the department, they are going to focus on what did the company do, how did it run its ship, and what was the overall impact. In this case, as we said earlier, the Department of Education will be asking those same questions as it reviews the affairs of these numerous colleges across the country.
All right. So I thought it might be helpful for us to share, while we are seeing a little bit of new twist in terms of some of the facts related to college admission scandals, this is no new news regarding recruiting scandals. And in the celebration of March Madness and being from Memphis, Tennessee, I can't help but choose Derrick Rose as my favorite example on a recruiting issue gone bad. For those of you who are not familiar with this situation, back in 2008, Derrick Rose was recruited to be a one-and-done at University of Memphis by Coach John Calipari. They went to the March Madness finals and lost. And after that, there was an investigation done that resulted in a finding that Derrick Rose's SAT scores were invalid. In fact, he had or ACT scores, I can't remember which one it was. He had taken the test three times in his hometown of Chicago and did not have passing scores, went to Detroit, took the test, all of a sudden passing scores. There was an investigation done. They found that his scores were invalidated, which meant that he was not eligible to be a student at the University of Memphis or to participate on the basketball team. And so as a result of those findings, the NCAA ruled that he had played while academically ineligible because of his scores. The university itself was placed on 3 years of probation, but most importantly, they were required to return their revenue from the 2008 NCAA tournament, which was in excess of $600,000. This was back in 2008, so it's probably a lot more nowadays. They also found violations in other programs. What's interesting to note is that we consider this here in Memphis kind of as a black mark on our city and on the program, and people were very disgruntled by it all. But there's a lot of articles out there that say Derrick Rose was untouched. He was one and done. He moved on after that final championship game, and as we all know, went to be a successful NBA player. And everyone knows what happened to Coach Cal, who's successfully coaching at Kentucky. A more recent example is the what I call the Adidas scandal. And this is a pay-for-play issue where parents were being played to steer their high school-age students to an Adidas-sponsored university. This involved an NBA agent and two Adidas executives. They tape-recorded phone calls and found that there was wire fraud in addition to other types of fraud, where they paid one family $100,000 to have their son agree to attend and play basketball at Louisville. So the FBI did a three-year investigation on this. The focus was on these families of recruits. They found that payments ranged anywhere from the $2,500 range all the way up to the $100,000 range. There were, in addition to sanctions and financial penalties, there were prison sentences discussed. Now, there were potential sentences for up to 20 years, but actually just in the beginning of March, there was a finding that one of the men who was charged got a 9-month sentence and the other two got a 6-month sentence. I think it was kind of shocking to some of us that the sentences were so short. Of course, the arguments on the behalf of them, the defendants, was that they had no criminal history, they'd never been arrested, they had never served any time for anything, and this was just their one poor decision in life. And so the sentences were short. But I thought it was interesting to see U.S. Attorney's statement that says that these men deprived the universities of their economic rights and tarnished an ideal which makes college sports a beloved tradition by so many fans all over the world. There was evidence in the Adidas case that the coaches were aware, at least aware, of some of these illicit and illegal activities, and at least one coach lost his job and was terminated as a result of that. And there were also charges involving Kansas and NC State with regard to the Adidas issue. So those are some very real types of damages, not only monetary damages, but people losing jobs, damages to the reputation of your college or your university that can be a result of this recruiting scandal. And we seem to think that similar types of damages will be sought in this current type of litigation.
Well, that concludes the substance of our presentation. I'll give a couple minutes in case anyone wants to submit any questions. Seconds here. But if not, I really want to thank all the panelists for their contributions. This was very informative, and reminder that these slides are available in the references area. Thank you again, and let's just wait one more second. But otherwise, we really appreciate you taking the time to come listen to our panel, and feel free to reach out to us if you have any questions. Thank you.